Very welcome on the talk on the way to COP26, UK, Glasgow. I'm Her Royal Highness Princess Abze Djigma, and it's my great honor to be with you today. And you know, the conversation will be fantastic. We have the pleasure, and we're fortunate to have with us today Dr. Professor Wolfgang Schuster, who has been the mayor of Stuttgart for 16 years and also a bright visioner for sustainable cities. He has been the vice president of the European Council for Regions and Municipalities. And during his mandate, he found that bright ideas creating the European Foundation for Education, because it does care about the sustainability. To win our future, we need to take the next steps. Most welcome, my dear friend, Wolfgang Schuster. And we will be joined by Vintura, Silva, the regional lead of the Regional Cooperation Center, UNFCCC, St. George, from the Caribbean. Very fantastic person who's walking the talk about mitigation. You will hear his expertise, his experience from Grenada. And also joining us from the Caribbean, you will hear those bright young girls from the Caribbean, Sheila, Ashley, and also Maria. Most welcome. And in the studio here, I have
Arifa, Umarella.
Arifa.
Arifa.
Arifa from?
From Rotterdam.
Great, fantastic. She's a student on the Applied Science from the University of Rotterdam. You will hear from her also what she do. Professor, if I may start with you, can you set the scene a bit and just let us know what you have been doing, your vision, and share with our audience and our young people? We really love to hear from you.
Thank you very much for this invitation. And this group shows we are living in one world. And we have a common responsibility, but also a common chance to change things, even if we are living under very different conditions. For me, it was always important that young people get a fair chance. And one very key point is what's going on with our climate. What's going on with our climate as an important part of our ecological transformation. And this is also part of the UN Agenda 2030, which is, as you know, a very important agenda to go step by step to a more sustainable living, working, world in the dimension in this three dimensions. And I think it's very important always also with the climate issue to think about these three dimensions, the social dimension, the ecological dimension, and the economic dimension. Because if you find a balance, finally we will be successful. Climate protection has to be done on the local level. Not on the moon, not anywhere, it's just local. And therefore it's so important to think about what can we do as citizens? What can a local administration do? How we can push the local administration to do more for improving the climate? How we can push the companies in our city to do more for the climate? And therefore for me it was important to start with education. Mm-hmm. Education, it sounds very simple, but it's important. Important starting in the kindergarten. That the youngsters, the little ones, get a feeling what that means to see a plant growing. And therefore I brought in our kindergartens, a little garden. And the kids plant this garden. They study the growing of plants. They care about. And that's, you know, because we need not only the technique, the intellectual approach, we need the emotion. And this is very emotional and effective. And then people say, oh, it's so beautiful, we have to protect it. We have to protect our nature.
I do agree with starting young on educating children about the climate and you knew how to grow plants and stuff. But also in the parents' home, you can also do certain things like that as well. Like how children learn how to read, you can do that from home as well. Like yes. how I said, to have, start a kitchen garden, children can learn how to grow plants, and it's a little bit more sustainable for their home as well by having a kitchen garden at home. And you don't need a lot of space, not
sure.
much, because we're here. We have yes. a kitchen garden outside, and it's pretty small, and yeah. we already have a pretty decent amount of plants.
Excellent. And you like cooking? Taking some herbs from the garden?
Yeah, I like to help my mom prepare some of them. However, I do get a little nervous around the stove because...
that is so I'm fantastic. So fantastic. Vintura, tell us a bit about locally. I know that it's really at the heart of what UNFCCC is doing, going local, meeting, bring the top to the town, and just listen to the people. And I know that you have a lot of expertise in the Caribbean.
Climate action is at the heart of every Caribbean. 1.5 degrees Celsius target to limit the global temperature rise. Below this target is
I know that you are a hard worker going and from one island to another island. The connectivity is not easy, but you do your job, bringing, going to dig, whether you are from with the network or not, you bring them in, and that is good. You leading by example. That is the key word that you said, and also organizing, structuring. And what we should bring in Ashley, who's by the way, the ambassador as well of UNICEF, who will be leading to Milan with those bright youth to represent the voice of the Caribbean. Ashley, your take on what just Vintura just said.
Well, hi everyone. I'm so excited to be here again. You know, I totally agree with what Vintura just said. Like, I mimic it, but I feel like from a governmental perspective and as it relates to youth engagement, our governments really need to do more because the policies in which they implement today have a lasting effect on our lives for tomorrow. Every individual person on this planet needs to play a role as it relates to tackling and fighting climate change.
I agree with you, but yourself, you have an organization. So tell us about that, because this is interesting also, that's going to empower your fellows to go in your path.
I started my advocacy actually at age 16, and it was centered on non-communicable diseases after hearing Barbados establishing an organization called the Schools Against Non-Communicable Diseases. But after doing my research and interacting with different experts and young advocates, we realized that there's a distinct correlation between health and the environment. And that's basically how Healthy and Environmentally Friendly Youth, which stands for HEY, campaign was formed. So the HEY campaign is a Caribbean-initiated campaign on climate change and health with a global outreach seeking to build bridges between youth in the Caribbean and around the world. Oftentimes, as young persons in the Caribbean, we are often not connected to youth from across the world. So that's what really makes the campaign special. So as a group of young persons, our vision is to create a generation of young people committed, and note the word that I'm using, committed to adopting healthy lifestyles that are both healthy and environmentally friendly, and also leading global advocacy efforts to build inclusive society.
And you know, guys, you're already on the leading chair. You're already on the seat. So you show and say, well, we are on the driving seat. We know what to do.
First of all, don't wait for the government.
Good.
Do yourself something. You know, it's always easy to say, oh, yeah, the government decided something and we wait till the government is doing something. No. In our democratic system, we, the citizens, are the active. And we can create NGOs. We can, for example, the question of energy supply, how we can change it.
Mm-hmm.
Very simple. We have many cooperatives to change the heating system and in schools, for example. We need heating, you need air condition. But the technique is the same. You have to use solar panels to reduce fossil energy, the consumption of fossil energy. Very simple. You can do it. Make a cooperative in your school and organize it. Or change the insulation of buildings, school buildings. There are many, many good examples what you can do as citizens, organizing yourself and being a strong voice and a credible voice. Because if you just say, oh, I wait for the government should decide. No. We do it. We are the citizens. We are part of a local governance system.
Arifa.
Yes.
Your thought on that. You have heard from your sisters from the Barbados, mm-hmm. and you and your with your study at the University of Rotterdam, mm-hmm. on applied science, and also your future job that you would like to do. What we should be doing, but what you heard from Vintura, Maria, Wolfgang, what we should be doing, and what is your thought on that?
I've been thinking a lot while listening to everybody, and I think it's really, I think we can all agree that it's really important to care about the climate, but a problem I've been seeing mostly around my generation,
yes.
is there's like a very big lack of genuine concern about the climate. Mm-hmm. And I think that while it's really good to start young, I think it's really important to just keep implementing it even till this day, because and even in online spaces, people of my age, there's either two approaches, either very nihilistic ideologies where they're like, it doesn't matter, we're all gonna die, I don't need to raise a family because the climate is going downwards. And then there's the type of people who really want to help, but they're seen as more extremist in a way, they're more active and therefore cast it out within communities because, oh, you're over exaggerating it, it's not that bad. And I think with Dutch, because we live in a very privileged country as in the Netherlands, they don't really see it as a big problem because it doesn't affect them in this way. So it's really interesting just to hear from my perspective at least, because yes. I think we all know how bad it is, but I don't think many youth consider it a problem, even though we're only 10 years away from trying to reach the goal of the responsibility goals, sustainability goals, you know. Yeah. So I'm just very overwhelmed with all the information I'm getting.
Yes. Today we have social media. It's very easy. It's very easy to show good examples. What you're doing in the Caribbean, what we are doing in Stuttgart, what we are doing in the Netherlands. So it's so easy to demonstrate it's possible. You can do good things and at the same time making a pressure on the public sector. Because you can say, well, let's see, it works. It worked there. Why it's not working here? What can we do that it will work? So I think it's so, today, thanks to social media, it gets so easy to be connected and to create such an alliance for climate action, which was never in the past possible. And therefore, I think it's so important to say, let's create this alliance, and then we are powerful.
What Wolfgang just said to us is just, you can just, that is a great idea, that is one of my takeaway. Start making a cooperative in your own school. This is obvious. Let's go, all of us do it. You don't need to, but from tomorrow, and your school, whether it's primary school, high school, university, you start a cooperative, you have shares and your cooperatives, and you start doing that. And that by doing so, you also can push the wheel in terms of policy, as he said, then the policymakers will jump in and start doing. So Maria, I like once what you said, I can't imagine why people cannot enjoy when in the morning I open my window and I see this. That's what I'm protecting, my coastal. picking up papers, picking up plastic. That's how she started. And that is, yeah, she didn't wait it for her government, for her local government, because she liked her environment. So can you share a little bit more and how far you are and how others also can join your movement, Maria? Please go ahead.
Well, I do have an Instagram, Thought Squad by Maria, and I post questions every now and then, and that helps to bring along a sort of community, and I can really see people are understanding the issues with climate change. And I had asked a question there, if when we, the Caribbean, or my island Barbados, is hit by a hurricane, is it the responsibility of other countries to come and help us? And I realized that some people said no. And I find that kind of sad, because we are the getting hit first most of the times by the hurricanes and most of the climate change. And it was stated that in the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change's 6th assessment report, that the tropics or the Caribbean is going to be hit a lot and most in times the first by climate change. And if no one's going to help us, none of the big producers of most of our garbage and the big manufacturers aren't going to help us, that means that we're kind of on our own and we're getting hit. It's really sad. And another thing is that I can only speak for my country, Barbados, because I know what's going on in this kind of time. However, my country has started something called the Roof to Reef Project. Mm-hmm. And our goal is to become environmentally friendly, I believe, by 2030. And already we have seen that 50% of our transport vehicles have been swapped out for electric vehicles. And I think next month, September, we are going to be planting trees, and I'm going to be attending that.
Excellent.
I've also noticed that even though with the electric vehicles, what are we going to do with those batteries? Sure, we could still keep the shell of the car and throw away the batteries, but how are we going to recycle these batteries? Are they even recyclable in the first place?
Absolutely.
And another thing is that with all these electronic vehicles, all these electronic items in general, I do believe that the batteries from these things, they can be recycled in some way. And I figured that we need to start trying to do that. Even though our island Barbados is very tiny, we can still try and do something to help limit the amount of waste we put out, because we do have a lot of waste and we're disposing of it pretty bad.
I salute that and embrace it. And you know, that's what we said. You already know what asking the right questions.
I think it's so important that we as consumers think about this life cycle.
Yes.
Second, what we need from the European level, at least in Europe by the European Commission, we need a clear regulation to come to a circuit economy. So that means, for me, I always think about triple zero.
Okay.
The production of the products, that means zero emission, zero fossil energy, and zero waste, because everything is reusable or recyclable or renewable.
Maria, if I may ask you your two action and snapshot.
As young people and everyone should in general be doing is, before you buy things, point of purchase, make sure you have an understanding of what you're going to do with this waste that you're going to generate after you buy the product. And then another one, as Ashley said, is simply just spreading the word. You can do this by just telling your friends at school or talking to your parents, because I know that a lot of people who are a lot of adults actually do not really have a good understanding of climate change, as sad as it may be.
Excellent. Has the right question to buy the product and go for the snowball effect. Convince your neighbor that, and then it's go. And how about you, Arifa, your snapshot on two concrete actions that we should be doing and Rotterdam that can be scaled and the other universities across the Netherlands.
I think I want to build upon what Ashley said. I think instead of actually more sensitizing, I'd like to desensitize the current attitude that my generation has in this country towards climate change. Because, like I said, there's a lack of concern. So I think we have to start with desensitization to see the seriousness of the situation and then also normalize caring about the environment and taking actions yourself.
If I may wrap up and add the essence, it's don't wait, be the change. Start doing it at your level. Start local, impact global. Be voice loud. Use the power, your own power, the social media like Ashley and Maria are doing. Asking the right question. We heard from Dr. Professor Wolfgang Schuster how he engaged with his citizens, the word citizen. We the citizens, we got to start doing the things. Engage also with the global funders. Ask to your bankers where my money goes. Are they climate sensitive? Are they gender sensitive? Are you thinking circular where the investment is going? I think that was the essence of our discussions of today. And I would like to have a final comment of each of you. I'm confident that you have a lot of expertise. Your one line.
I guess a general message more for people my age. Like, I know you could feel powerless in a situation like this. It feels like it's so much bigger than you. You don't know where to start. But honestly, even if you look at Ashley and Maria, like how much they're doing, even though they're just one person.
Yes.
If you just start somewhere, just small, you don't even know how much impact you have on you and the people around you and the people they know. Like, the interconnectivity can go really far. Even me, and I don't even know that much about the environment, or like, I'm not that well educated, but we can all see how serious it is. And if you just start with yourself, you know,
just start
you
with
can
yourself.
Go very far.
I take
life.
It from here.
Yeah.
I would like to say that we only have one environment. We must protect it. However, I would like to say something.
Yes.
Pertaining to consumerism. And I noticed this wasn't very recent, but when it pertains to medicine, I had read a story there about, it's called The Pearl by John Steinbeck. Mm-hmm. And it talks about how this baby was bitten by a scorpion. And there is this particular quote in this book. I'm reading it for school, by the way. Mm-hmm. And it had spoken to how the baby's scorpion bite was treated by a natural thing. The mother went to the ocean to pick some brown seaweed and made it into like the kind of mash and put it on the baby's shoulder. And even though it wasn't given the authority by the doctor, it was still as good as a cure as any, because it was is probably even better than the doctor's as well. And I just want to say that, because even though we are pushing medicine, we are pushing the doctor's medicine, there are still things in our natural environment that are very good for our bodies as well. Like, for example, I saw a child talking about how they had really bad acne, and other students had asked, but what do you use to treat your acne? And she had said aloe, and aloe is very good for your face. And she was laughed at because she wasn't using the average products that you can buy from the supermarket, which is seen as progressive. So I'd really like to change the way how people think about progression, because progression is not always about going to the supermarket to have to buy food. Growing your own food is very progressive in its own.
My short message would be that every one of us needs to take action now. And when we're taking action, ensure that our messaging is gender sensitive. It is inclusive to include persons that are living with minorities and with disabilities, and persons from minority groups must also be given a voice
as it relates to addressing climate action today.
We are part of the same bowl. Thank you for that. It was my great pleasure to welcome our guest today for the episode, and I look forward to other discussions with you. And thank you so much for watching us. Stay tuned. I'm Her Highness Princess Abze Djigma, and I look forward to collaborate with you. What you're doing is important, and we're grateful for what you're doing at your level. Thank you for that. Thank you for Mother Nature.